So let's see if the technique here still works. Because that will be a bummer, right? First talk and already something going wrong? Nah, I don't think so. I don't hope so, at least. Ah, it's there, right. Quite a turnout, actually. Wow, nice. It's nice to see all of you. Today I want to talk about something that I said was a component today keeps the doctor away. Well, actually, no, I'm not going to talk about that. What I'm going to talk about is something that is close to my heart, and that is being able to be lazy. And one way of doing that is making other people build stuff for you that you can reuse. But it sometimes also means that you are going to build stuff that other people are going to reuse. And that's what my talk will be about. In my spare time, I'm a passionate developer for a music streaming program. I asked myself a question. Well, I gave myself a task. I want to display some album art. So I've got for you an artist, maybe an album name, and I want to make that magic happen without me ever having to think about that again. So if, for example, I want to display the art for the artist Arian, which is one of my favorite artists, or maybe one of my favorite compact discs, which is Anima by Tool. So how can I get these pictures in here so quick? Well, of course, my computer is already on for 10 days, so I downloaded them and it's all offline, blah, 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 blah. It's a simple statement, but actually I had to do quite a lot to make this work. I have to find the album art. Maybe I have multiple resources that I can check where that album art is, and I have to query them all, find the fastest, and store them somehow. I want to add some caching so that the next time I open the music program, I don't have to query it online again, and I can just get it from my local cache. I want to optimize those images so that they're not like full HD while I'm only using them in a 200 by 200 pixel grid. And many, many other things. And today I want to do this all without bothering you how the details of this exercise works. I just want to give it to you. Well, what I did in the past was, this is all pseudocode, by the way. If you copy paste this in your console, it will explode. What I did in the past was create a simple function, or, well, give my fellow developer a simple function that he could use to download the art. In this case, I would do some magic, and that magic will return an image tag containing the correct image. I'm not going to bother you with the other lines of this script, but trust me, it works. If I have that script, I can use it in my page. So what I had to do was add it to my page as a script, add some placeholder where I can put it in, and then write some extra script to actually put the data in that DOM element. And of course, what I just wrote is something that you should never do, because I'm using inner HTML here while I'm trusting a third-party developer. No. And it works. Until it becomes too complex, and because you need some shared knowledge, right? You need to know about how to implement that script and what kind of attributes or objects you need to put in, and what the output is. Or it requires a lot of copy pasting. Who is responsible for the styling? And one of my other hobbies, next to making a music player, is writing date pickers. And never ever try to write a date picker by copy-pasting. Thank you. I don't want to do that anymore. I want to stop writing date pickers for once and for all. And I know, to end this one, is I know that an iframe is not always the solution. So what is? Well, of course, what is the solution? Write it in your favorite framework. Fix it. Oh, but we're using the other framework, the not my favorite framework. Boo. So have fun writing your enormous components in that framework that you don't want to use. And use TypeScript, by the way. Oh, I'm off for a beer, said my least favorite coworker or boss type of person. Right, but I'm here to help. My name is Lucien Immink. I'm a Bachelor of Engineering, and I'm hopefully not that person that I just referred to. This is my face. this is what I do. I'm a software architect and front-end evangelist at Isaac. And like Koen said, this is my dream. Thank you all for coming. This is where we work. I will share the link to this presentation when I'm done, and you can zoom out far enough to understand where it exactly is. But it's in Eindhoven. This is the solution to all my problems I just described. Web components. But to understand why web components is my solution, I need to understand what they do. And to understand what they do, I need to understand what they are. And to start off, I want to start off with the templates. With templates, which is an element, an HTML element, where you can sort of store your markup before you are going to use it. So as an example here, I've just the red line in my talk is that component with the album art, of course. Here I'm just writing down a simple template for displaying a card with art, an artist, and its bio. I've also used a slot here. Maybe you can see that. A slot is a way to determine for the third party, for you as the first party, to determine where your third party developer can put its HTML or external data when it's using your template. Right? Okay. What's important to know about a template is that it's not live. So if you put this in your document, every image that's inside the template will not be downloaded. No CSS is applied to any of the nodes inside the template, and if you have added scripts to it, those scripts are not executed. But we can use JavaScript. Of course, what else? To make this template live. And to do that, we just check if we are capable of using a template. And if not, well, you're on your own. But if you can use the template, we can clone the template so we can reuse it over and over and over again. Query the data, put in the correct URL, for example, for the image, add it to the DOM, and boom, it's live. That means the image is downloaded, the CSS is applied, the JavaScript is executed. But with templates alone, we're not there yet. What we also have in the web components are the custom elements. And a custom element is magic. It's really the magic. It's the ability to create a custom element that encapsulates your own functionality into an HTML page, rather than having to do with a long and nested batch of elements that together provide that same custom page feature. So the next time that I have to copy-paste the code that I need for my date picker, it's one line instead of a lot more. And to create a custom element is quite easy. The first thing that you have to do is extend the HTML element, or you can extend the built-in HTML elements. I'll come back to that shortly. Start off with the constructor that needs to call it super first, of course, and then you can add your magic again. So it's the same code that you had before, but in a different way. Registering it to your document is just calling the define function of the custom elements namespace and adding it. The first part you see, the string, is the identifier of the node that you will see. So every time I put in an album-art, it will call the function or the class that I've built in the album art, capitals, class that I just referred to. And like I've said, you can customize built-in elements. So in this example, I extend the UL element, the unordered list. I can, for example, do something with it. I have no idea. The thing is, I can extend it, but I have to think about the consequences. At one hand, you have actually no easy way to find out if you are using a custom element or a built-in. On the other hand, if the custom element fails for some reason, your fallback is your normal built-in element. And to use this, you have to assign it to the built-in element with the is attribute. And now I can use them anywhere. So I built my class, I registered it, and now I can use it. So in my hip-hop page on my music player, I have the bio for Tupac here, which is, of course, the Krizzle, Alizzle, Badang, Swang, check it out, Manizzle. If you want to know more about Lorem Ipsum in a way that's fun to use, you can use this URL to generate it for you because we're lazy, right? I've got my templates, I've got my custom elements. Well, if I can't react to the lifecycle of the element, I don't know when what happens. So in the Web Component Standard, there are four different callbacks that you can use. One is the connected callback. That means the custom element is added to a page. And if you can connect, you can disconnect. So the disconnect is the exact same opposite. If it's going to be removed, you can do your cleanup, for example. There's also the adopted callback, and that was one that I actually myself never used, so I had to look it up. But apparently, this is called when you move your element from one page to another on the same page, iframes. And one of the most important, I think, is the attribute changed callback. So if programmatically or somebody opened the console and changed the attribute name, this callback is triggered. And you can, for example, find out that it's no longer Tupac that you needed to find, but Jay-Z. Templates, custom elements. Next up is the shadow DOM, because one of the things that you have when you share your code with one another is that it's almost impossible not to leak or not to get in conflict with the other page. If I define a CSS statement, is that only for my element or for the whole page? Well, by default, it's for the whole page. So I have to prefix my own element to make sure that nobody else is not using that same prefix. So it's based on trust. With the shadow DOM, you can add a hidden DOM tree to elements that are in your regular DOM tree. And the beauty here is that now my function and style cannot leak. A picture says more than 1,000 words. At the left-hand side, we have the document tree with the shadow tree, and on the right-hand side, they're entwined, and that's more how the render engine really uses it. The thing is, the most important thing here is the shadow tree that you see on the right-hand side. And to attach a shadow tree to an element is, again, quite simple. I think I can copy-paste this with getting away with it. You see that I've added the mode open to it. That's an attribute that you can add. And it says that if you put in open in the mode, elements can be accessed by JavaScript from outside of your custom element. The opposite is closed, but that's sort of a lie because you can still access them. You will see open being used more than closed anywhere. With that shadow tree, I can now build my own shadow DOM with it. And that's actually quite easy. It's just like the normal DOM, and it's just like the normal elements that I would add. But the beauty is that I've added an image here that if I want to, for example, query that image for my styling, I don't have to think about my scope anymore because it's already scoped because it's in the shadow DOM. So every image will be display block. Well, every image in the shadow DOM. And of course, you can also write the CSS and host it somewhere else. Yes, that's possible, but think of the consequences again, because what is a URL? So if I put in a relative URL, is that, oh, wait a minute, that's a URL on that page that's not mine somewhere else on the internet. Oh. So only use absolute URIs if possible. Well, actually, try to encapsulate your CSS in the element. And then, of course, we need to make it a bit more difficult than it is already. And Google started out with custom elements a few years ago. While it wasn't the standard yet, I think Microsoft could have told them that it wasn't a good idea. But anyway, so they had their own standard for custom elements or for web components. And then when the original, well, the actual standards came out, the syntax was different. So you now have a V0 versus V1. And V0 are outdated, not updated anymore, only works in Chrome. and it shouldn't be used anymore. So if you want to go forward, just use the V1 implementation. So I have my web component. Yay, I'm done. No, not really, not yet. I'm almost done. Because I don't want to do this. Because I'm writing my application in something else. I'm writing my music player, for example, in Angular. I don't know why. I'm writing it in Angular. And if I want to use my custom element in Angular, I have to do something extra. I have to, first of all, tell Angular that I want to use the custom elements scheme. Because otherwise, the compiler will complain about the fact that my custom element isn't part of the HTML standard. Then I can import my custom element and use it. But I'm not using Angular anymore. I'm using React. Ah, phew. I just have to import and use it. Now I'm on the other side of the podium, so now I'm using Vue, of course. A lot can happen when you walk from one side to the other side of a podium. In Vue, I have to tell the Vue compiler that it shouldn't be checking if album art, again, is something that it should do something with. And then I can use it. Why am I showing this? Well, I'm showing this to hopefully help you understand that incorporating a web component in one of these bigger libraries is super easy. And if you want to change out a specific portion of your website or web application, maybe done by another team somewhere else and on the other end of the world, maybe another team in the same company that says, don't go there. You should use React. Well, by all means, do. Do use React, but expose it as a custom element using the web component standard. And I can use it with my Svelte or whatever framework I'm using today. But maybe I can even skip the whole framework, because the framework like Vue or like React or even, of course, Angular will also include some overhead. Some could be around 300 kilobytes of overhead. And to just create web components, there are also other libraries that you can use. And I've listed a few. There are many, many, many more, of course. And probably by the end of the day, a new framework has been introduced. For me, the first two are the ones that I actually prefer to use, LitElement and Stencil. They both give me a lot of helping functionality so that I have to write less and they do more. Polymer is on its way back. And if you go to the Polymer website, one of the first lines is, well, you should check out LitElement because it's awesome. And we're Polymer. And Skate.js is a hybrid sort of thing that says, well, if you want to use React, Preact, or LitElement as a renderer, by all means, include that as the renderer and write your code using that renderer. We'll do the web component part for you. In the end, pick the one that suits you best, where you can be as productive as you must be or like to be. I also want to give you some examples before I wrap things up. In my work, I sometimes have to write a UML diagram. Anyone else here in the room who has to write those things? Yeah, I see a few hands. During our meetups at ISAC, I introduced the idea of a web component a few months back. And the last time we were there, my heart was filled with excitement because somebody actually built a web component to render UML diagrams for me. Yes! So this means that the next time I'm updating my developer hub, I just have to update the planned UML text that you see above, and the picture that's below will be automatically generated. And that's something that I tend to forget. So it's now automated for me. I cannot forget it anymore. While I'm using web components, I also like to generate my API, and you can use, just have to check it for to be sure, yeah, a web component analyzer. That's a tool that you can use to analyze how your web component is built up. That will generate a JSON file that you can then parse and show on your developer hub. But then again, I don't have to anymore because somebody wrote a component for it. Now, I wanted to show you a date picker, but I won't. Because we all know there are date pickers out there. And otherwise I can help you with writing your own date picker. But you can also use web components not only for functional elements like I've shown you here before. You can also use them as utility components to help out, for example, your CMS users that don't know anything about how to write a proper grid or a proper modal, overlay, takeover, wizard, endless list that actually performs instead of just showing all the 10,000s of list items that there are in the list. You can help them out. I started this whole talk with the fact that I wanted to build something for fetching my album art. And so I did. And here it is. Yay! No, this is the code. This is actually what I now give myself when I put on my other pad and I'm now going to rebuild my UI again. Not my web art anymore, because that's now a web component. I just have to reuse it, because I'm now rewriting my application in Svelte, because I don't know. But what I can do here now, and this is going to be very, very interesting, of course, because I'm going to live demo, is show you the album art of those two lines that I've put in. So the first one is the artist called The Gathering, and the second is, of course, the best album of the year. And now I just want to know from somebody in the audience, for example, you there, sir, what's your favorite artist?
Dream Theater.
Dream Theater, well. To show you that this is actually live code, I will try to find my cursor. There it is. Oh, this is actually harder than I thought it would be. Okay. Easy now. All right, so when I practiced, my talk was 5 minutes and my live demo, never mind. Do we have internets? Yes, we have. And there is Dream Theater. Oh. And that's why you live demo if it works and you get applause. Oh, yay. Okay, so it comes to this. We have web components. And I've shown you that web components are APIs to create custom and reusable HTML tags with control style and markup. I've shown you that a custom component that is built on the web component standard can work across with modern browsers in any JavaScript library or framework as long as it works with HTML. Sorry. I've shown you that web components are built out of HTML templates, custom elements, and the shadow DOM. And I hope that I gave you that web components can integrate very well with the modern frameworks. That there are multiple libraries that you can choose from to make you more productive while using them. I think, personally, that they have a great future. And I've shown you that they can fetch album art. And with that, I'd like to thank you.
Thank you, Lucien.
Thank you.